The brain is an organ of my body and everything, but the mind, you know, that's where our essence is. That's where we live. That's where we exist and everything. So, you know, I had to learn that my problem was not with alcohol, but my problem was in my mind. And then once I learned where my problem was, I could then proceed to fix it, okay? Or attempt to fix it. I also learned that I couldn't fix it. You know, I had to have some help with this, but you know, guys know what I mean. Okay. Last week, we finished up with Bill's story. You know, and we're going to start on chapter 2 tonight. That starts on page 17. And chapter 2 is entitled, There Is a Solution. Okay, if you're new, if you're coming back, and you don't have much hope for yourself at the moment, just realize that there is a solution to this problem, okay? And they've even entitled an entire chapter of the book to the solution. And what we're going to do is this chapter is going to start, you know, describing to us, if you look for it, it's going to start talking about those mental twists that we have. That I think the book refers to it as those peculiar mental twists. All right, the way our thoughts develop, the way our thinking goes when we're afflicted with this disease, because that really is what makes us different from the rest of the people. You know, I have Dr. Silkworth told me it's an allergy of the body and an obsession of the mind. Okay, and so yeah, I do have this allergy. This physical allergy, where I start to drink, that once I start, I react differently, and I where most people, normal people, will stop after one or two or something like that. I get to six or seven and say, "Hey, we're getting going now. Give me some more." You know, so that's an abnormal reaction. But to go along with that is my thought process, this obsession of the mind. Okay, and how that takes me along is, you know, I'm constantly planning and looking for that next drink. Now, I told you guys that I grew up in Rhode Island, and in Rhode Island, the liquor stores aren't open on Sundays, you know. And I moved from Rhode Island to Connecticut. Connecticut, they're not open on Sundays either. But in Rhode Island, they close at 10 o'clock, and I learned the hard way. In Connecticut, they close at 8 o'clock. So I had to plan and make sure that I had enough available, you know. So I'm constantly thinking about this, and I hated running out, you know. So that, normal people don't think that way. They don't act that way, you know. Normal people don't have bottles stashed all over the house, you know. So, you know, there is something to our mind, our thought process. And hopefully we'll see some of that in this chapter, okay. So starting here on page 17, it says, chapter 2, There Is a Solution. Starts off, we of Alcoholics Anonymous know thousands of men and women who were once just as hopeless as Bill. Okay? And think of that, you know, just as hopeless as Bill, seemingly as hopeless as Bill. They know thousands of these folks already, all right? Because Bill, we just read his story, and he sounded pretty hopeless until he found the solution. Okay? And once he found the solution, you know, that he was able to proceed from there. And here's what they say in the very next sentence. Nearly all have recovered. Okay, those thousands of people that were seemingly as hopeless as Bill, stuck in a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body, nearly all of them have recovered. They have solved the drink problem. All right, now look at that. You know, you talk about promises. I mean, I go to a lot of meetings where they read, quote unquote, the promises. You know, those are the promises from step 9. Okay, they come later on in the book. You're going to find all sorts of promises all throughout this book. And if you're new and coming in here, and you know, I was asked to speak at a meeting last night, and you know, I brought up at one point in my life, I had said to my wife, why don't you just let me go and check into a hotel room and drink myself to death? You know, she wouldn't let me do that, but that's how hopeless I felt at that time. You know, so if you're new and you're feeling that way, these folks have solved the problem. They used to be that way. They have found a solution to this problem. And as we go through the book, we're going to learn what that solution is. Okay? They go on here on page 17. It says, we are average Americans. All sections of this country and many of its occupations are represented, as well as many political, economic, social, and religious backgrounds. We are people who normally would not mix, but there exists among us a fellowship, a friendliness, and an understanding which is indescribably wonderful. Okay. They're talking about that bond that you develop once you get in here, okay, that fellowship that goes on here. You know, he says, we are like the passengers of a great liner the moment after rescue from a shipwreck when camaraderie, joyousness, and democracy pervade the vessel from steerage to captain's table. Unlike the feelings of the ship's passengers, however, our joy in escape from disaster does not subside as we go our individual ways. Okay, you know, I don't know if any of you ever saw that movie, The Unsinkable Molly Brown. You know, it's an old movie. I'm not sure when it was made, but I remember seeing it on television on the late shows a couple times. Well, Molly Brown actually was one of the survivors of the Titanic. And even though it's a movie, it's based on fact. But, I mean, you think about the Titanic. That ship was going down. And they talk about, you know, normally people who would not mix. I mean, on that ship you had first class, second class, third class, and then you had the steerage and everything. And in first class people, the people in steerage, that was down below decks in the ship. And they were not allowed up above decks. They were not allowed to mingle with the other people, you know. And first class, you know, I wasn't there, I don't know for certain, but I'm going to say they were kind of snobby, you know, and looked down upon the people in third class and the people in steerage. They wanted nothing to do with them, all right? But what happened once the ship started sinking? They didn't care who was in the lifeboat. Just let me in there, you know? And so at that point in time, you know, they were desperate enough that they were going for it, and they were being rescued. They were being saved. But as time progressed, and after they got ashore and everything, and the news let go, and things started to settle down, they went their separate ways, okay? The disaster was over. But in here, what they're telling us, it's not like that, you know? We're different from that. We all suffer from the same problem, this same disaster in our lives, all right? And we find a common solution in here. And normally, a lot of us wouldn't talk to one another on the street. We wouldn't hang out together, you know? I might run into you in the bar, and you know, you might be my drinking buddy there for the night, you know? But next morning, I ain't calling you up again. I may show up tomorrow night at the bar and look over and say, hey, where's Joe? You know, but that's about as far as I went, you know? So it says here in the book, the feeling of having shared and common peril is one element in the powerful cement which binds us. But that in itself would never have held us together as we are now joined. Okay, so they're starting to talk about the fellowship. And even though we share this common denominator, that's not all that keeps us together. It says here, the tremendous fact for every one of us is that we have discovered a common solution. Okay. We have a way out on which we can absolutely agree. You hear that? These guys have a way out of this situation. All right? We have a way out on which we can absolutely agree and upon which we can join in brotherly and harmonious action. There's another key word there, action. You know, we got to do something. Yeah. I didn't like that. I'm a lazy bastard. I don't like to work if I don't have to. This is the great news this book carries to those who suffer from alcoholism. Right. And think about that statement for a second. It is pretty great news. If you're suffering from this, they're telling us that they have a way out. They have a solution. And if you're down in the dumps and fighting with this thing, just think about that for a minute. There is hope. Hundreds of people they're talking about here as we do it. Well, actually, in the beginning of this paragraph, they talk about thousands, right? And this was published in 1939. If we go back looking now, I mean, if you went and counted it up, we're talking about millions of people, you know? So going on over onto page 18, it says here, an illness of this sort, and we have come to believe in an illness, involves those about us in a way no other human sickness can. Okay? And so, you know, this is something that Dr. Silkworth told us. At the time, Dr. Silkworth was putting his medical reputation, his professional reputation out on the line, out on a limb, by going out and saying, hey, this is a disease. I was told that the American Medical Association didn't recognize this as being a disease till sometime in the 50s. And like I said, here it is. This book is being printed in 39, and Silkworth had been working with Wilson for a while and so many other drunks coming in New York and everything, you know. And so he says, an illness of this sort, and we have come to believe in an illness, involves those about us in no other way, in a way no other human sickness can. And think about what they say here for a second. It says, if a person has cancer, all are sorry for him and no one is angry or hurt. But not so with the alcoholic illness. For with it, there goes annihilation of all things worthwhile in life. All right? You get afflicted with this and it annihilates your life. But it's not just you that's being affected by it. You know, for the longest time, I thought I was the only one being affected by it. In fact, I used to say to my wife and some other people, just leave me alone. I'm not hurting anybody but me. Why can't you leave me alone? You know, it wasn't until I actually went through and did the fourth step that I realized some of this stuff and just how far and how widespread it is. But we touch everybody that we're involved in. And here's what, they try and give us some examples here. It says,